one screen here, so people who are seated over there might want to call and some other friends of APU. We were hoping to see many more of those, but it's all right, really. We'll keep this intimate and nice. That's fine by me. So, good morning, everybody. And I was hoping Anurag would be here, but he's kind of caught up with interviews, and I don't know what he's doing, really. Okay, so the Philosophy of Education unit at APU is very pleased indeed to be hosting this event, this talk by Stephen Phillips, who is Professor of Philosophy and Asian Studies, University of Texas at Austin. I assume you've all received the virtual flyer that was sent out, so I'm not going to take up time listing the accomplishments of today's speaker. But I will say one thing in passing and in deep appreciation, that Stephen has this consistent ability, really, to produce these works of astonishing lucidity on material that is both difficult and remote, but remote to some extent for us today. And as a student of philosophy, and surprisingly to myself, an instructor of philosophy, I, along with a lot of others who are right now not present in this room, owe Stephen a great debt of gratitude. I believe the technical term is rina, and I've also read somewhere that there are some debts of this nature, some rina, that can't be paid off at all, right? So there's no point cutting off your right thumb or your left, the left hemisphere of your brain. That's just not gonna work. So all one can really do is acknowledge that debt with humility. So I'll shut up now and step aside and ask Stephen to address.
Om Aim Saraswatyai Swaha Mahurya Namaskara. Oh, that's not good. Someone have the control of the sound. Okay. Thank you very much for coming. The topic of an ethics of testimony and a Naiyayika reading of the Gita, in particular this verse, yad yada chatati shreshtas tad tadaiva itaro janas yat pramanam kudate lokas tad anuvartate, that that is focused upon by a great member of the Nyaya School of Philosophy. The Nyaya School runs, about 2,000 years. There's some debate about its beginning, whether it was, say, 200 BCE or maybe 200 CE or AD, but it had a very substantial literature from about 1000 on. I mean, there are earlier strata to this school's literature from the Nyaya, the earliest text, the Nyaya Sutra, and the earliest commentaries, but from about 1000 on, this school becomes quite prolific with, as we move through the later centuries of the classical Indian era, where Sanskrit was the medium of intellectual communication among philosophers and others of the high culture. Nyaya really became quite prolific in its treatment of various topics and logic, epistemology, ontology, and so on. But the Nyaya school, and I think Nyaya, maybe it's not so well known to us these days as, say, some of the other classical schools, such as Vedanta, and the branches of Vedanta, such as Advaita Vedanta and Vishishta Dvaita Vedanta, partly because, you know, the Vedanta schools are supported by, what should we say, religious perspectives, by, you know, the Vedic tradition and the Upanishads and the Gita. And it's not to say that members of the Nyaya school didn't also read the Bhagavad Gita and the Upanishads, but the very word Nyaya means something like critical reasoning. And so, and particularly in the early period, the Nyaya philosophers were not particularly attracted to religion and often opposed popular ideas, sort of with the motto that anything that we can't rationally defend, we don't accept. And then Nyaya takes the lead in among the various so-called Hindu schools in combating the Buddhist philosophies. And one of the great debates in all of world philosophy is the debate between the Yogacara Buddhist philosophers and the Naiyayika philosophers that goes on round after round. We have one great Nyaya philosopher, you know, saying his whole purpose is to write is to keep the Buddhists from confusing people with their bad arguments, and then Buddhists responding to Nyaya, and then another round, and so on. The Buddhists cease to be Nyaya's principal opponent after the invasions of North India in, say, 1100-1200, where the Buddhists move north, and the Naiyayikas focus more on another school, Mimamsa. And both of these literatures really flourish in the centuries 1200, 1300, 1400, 1500, and so on. But the debates concern mainly how we know things, the nature of the world, the nature of a human being, human psychology, consciousness, how we know ourselves, and not a whole lot of attention is paid to ethics. There's philosophy of religion, even though in the beginning, in the early periods of Nyaya, there's not much concern with Ishvara, but by the time we come to Udayana, who is the Naiyayika that I refer to here in the title of the talk, about 1000, Udayana is a theist, and he puts forth some arguments for the existence of God. But it's not the Vedantic God; it's a philosopher's God that he is defending and proposing to prove by argument, a God that doesn't create the world, though, because atoms are eternal, God arranges atoms. Selves are eternal. God doesn't create selves. So God is proposed or defended philosophically by arguments and conceived of just in a way that will, so that God can do the explanatory task, such as arranging atoms, that whatever the argument is relies on. So, for example, if we have an argument from things being well ordered, then of course God has to be supposed to have the knowledge necessary to order things properly. But that doesn't mean that God is omnipotent or all pervasive or all those sort of attributes that are given to God according to the Vedantins. It's very much a philosopher's God that has a certain explanatory role in the Nyaya system. Theological topics are added to Nyaya's concern with knowledge and the self and the nature of the world, but again, not so much about ethics. And so I've had to do some, how do I get to the next screen? It's just hit the, excuse me. Okay. So yes, this is Nyaya's principal concern, is how we know. In fact, Nyaya takes over a lot of the theory about what we know, the objects of the world, from another school, and they're mainly concerned with the nature of argument and how we show that we know something or other. And so we cite, if someone asks us, how do we know, I don't know, how do I know that my wife's here in the room? Well, I know it by perception. How do I know that the water fountain is working? Well, I might ask and someone might tell me. And so I'd know that by testimony. Various things we know by inference. For example, if we see smoke rising from a mountain, well, we don't see fire, but we know that there's fire there. We know that by inference. And by analogy, we know the meanings of words. So this is Nyaya's principal concern, is knowledge sources. Then they move into ontology, the nature of the world, types of things there are in the world, selves, property bearers, properties. And again, there's not very much about ethics. Now, in contemporary philosophy, which is pretty much worldwide and sort of the nature of academic disciplines, there's a division that's quite current, that between what's called character ethics versus criterion ethics. And characteristic ethics is not very well represented in Western traditions, with the exception of Aristotle. Of course, you say, well, that's a very big exception, and indeed it is. But Aristotle's focusing on character is not really picked up so much by, in particular, the modern and early modern philosophers, who are concerned instead with criterion. And I think let's start with criterion. What's meant by criterion ethics? Well, criterion is looking for the standard or the way in which we can differentiate right actions from wrong actions intellectually. So how can we make judgments to say, this you know, murder is a bad thing to do, I don't know, charity is a good thing to do. How do we make those determinations intellectually? And we have to have a certain standard or criterion that would tell us, well, this kind of action is a good action, this kind of action is a bad action. We can also judge moral character. This person's a good person, this person's a bad person. But why? How do we justify our positions? Well, we justify it with respect to some theory that provides a way of distinguishing, or what we might want to call a criterion. And so, as I say, particularly the ethics of the 17th, 18th, 19th centuries in the West were consumed by the question of what is the criterion of right action and judgment of character. In contrast with this interest, the philosophies of India, including Buddhism and Jainism, the so-called Gnostica philosophies opposed to the Astika philosophies that accept Vedic culture, we have a focus on character. And you say, that's not really ethical theorizing to sort of list character traits such as charity, readiness to assist, service, truthfulness, and so on. Why should these characteristics be those that we deem are morally respectable, and other characteristics like thievery and murderousness that be judged in a negative way? Well, that's to shift again back to the criterion side. And what the people who think that that there's a kind of primacy to focusing on character. What they say in response to that is that it's the person of good character who is able best to judge what is right and what is wrong. To have an intellectual theory to be able to discern intellectually what is right or wrong, it can be quite misleading. We're going to come up with, as all the ethical theories do, various dilemmas, various puzzles, because ethical decision making is, after all, quite complicated. And you know, these people who put forth theories of the criterion of right action do so in an abstract way, supposing that their utilitarianism or their categorical imperative or whatever applies to every imaginable human situation of ethical decision making, which and clearly it doesn't. Whereas, so to have a focus on character has actually trumps these people, a concern with trying to get ethical knowledge by discerning the right standards of judgment of action has the advantage that, well, when a person, it takes a really, in this, maybe this is not the best analogy, but I'll try it anyway, that it takes a good musician to be able to judge the best music. Not just any lay person can be the judge. You have to, be immersed in the particular area. You have to yourself have good character in order to be able to appreciate all the factors that go into determining what's the right thing to do in some particular situation. So that's sort of the general layout of the contemporary debate. But that idea comes up in many contexts, that it is the person of good character in the classical Indian text that is the best judge of the way to proceed, as we find, for example, Krishna giving advice to Arjuna in the Bhagavad Gita. Now, the Nyaya philosophers, I think, take this sort of view about character, they just take it for granted, and they have pretty much the same view as everybody else has. Now, the tie, though, that they make, as with lots of other philosophies, in particular the Buddhist, the Yoga Sutra does this, is to a kind of prudential payoff, if I can put it so crudely, in making progress towards enlightenment, or nirvana, or mukti. So that it's thought that by having good character, maybe you're in the situation where, you're in the grocery store, no one can possibly catch you stealing from the bins, and so you know that you'll get away with it. But if you somehow can resist, that's good. That shows that you have a certain moral character that may not be rewarded by having the merchandise at your hand that you could have had had you been a thief, but you build up good karma that, well, even if it doesn't, it's thought that good karma actually can, in some systems, of having good character can just paves the way. It is a kind of pathway to the summum bonum. But even if you don't make it to a summum bonum, the idea is those dispositions of non-thievery that you build up in this lifetime. No, not every disposition, not all your memories will you be able to retrieve in your next lifetime, but some of your deep moral dispositions, for example, to good behavior, to charity, to readiness to assist, service, truthfulness, and so on, they stay with you and manifest in your personality in the next lifetime. So there is So there is a kind of personal payoff. And so usually these lists of virtues that make, you know, in some a good character are treated in the context of soteriology as a path to the summum bonum. But I want to do something different with them. And this is where I may be going a little bit beyond the tradition, though I take my lead from Udayana, this 10th century Nyaya philosopher that I've already mentioned. But I want to explicitly answer the criterion question from the Nyaya point of view. And I must say that in preparation for this talk, I searched through Udayana as best I could, and I couldn't get anything quite exactly what I wanted. So ultimately, the Naiyayika reading of Gita 3.21 is not going to be Udayana's, it's going to be myself, my own. I consider myself a Naiyayika, and it's this is going to be my own, I must say, it's sort of filling in what I think Udayana, in my heart of hearts. I'm not lying to you. I am one who knows the truth here and wants to communicate it faithfully. and about this, no, I'm making somewhat of a joke here, but let's do look at testimony, because testimony is going to be key. Remember, if we can go back to what are the justifiers of positions in the Nyaya system, and they are perception, inference, and testimony. Analogy is confined to learning the meanings of words. And so the analogy is not really very much used by the philosophers. I have it up here because it is one of the knowledge sources according to Nyaya. But so when it comes to an ethical claim, like that person did something that's wrong or that charitable act is a good thing to do, what would the justification be according to a Nyaya philosopher? How would you purport to give an argument to say that, you know, to support your view that, well, it's not going to be perception? Because much of moral judgment has to do with what we're going to do in the future. And this is an argument that's made in the Mimamsa Sutra, I think it's 115, right at the very beginning. It says perception tells us about what's present, and from that we can tell what's past, but it doesn't tell us about the future. And inference is dependent upon perception, so inference can't tell us either. So it has to be testimony. So what is testimony? Testimony is defined in the Nyaya Sutra, the Sutra 117, as the statement of an expert. Then an expert is defined. There are two conditions on being an expert. One is that the person knows the truth about the particular question and matter. And second, there is an ethical requirement built in the very concept of an expert. Because an expert has to be a person, it's, you know, it's not enough. If you're going to learn something by testimony from an expert, it's not enough that the person who's testifying knows the truth. He or she has to communicate it faithfully without any deception, not be a liar, have any intention to deceive. Okay. So it seems to me that it's just quite straightforward to take the Nyaya criterion theory in ethics to be a theory of testimony, that it is the testimony for Dharma. And you know, if this is not said in so many words, it is pretty plain in as a presupposition of several sutras. And the earliest stratum of Nyaya doesn't have much to say about the Veda. But it does have a couple of sutras where it says, you know, that the Veda is the testimony. We can know that certain sacrifices will bring results, and you know, in heaven for us, even though those things are imperceptible and we can't know them by perception, because the Veda is a kind of testimony. But then concerning societal norms, and what I mean by norms are standards of right and wrong action, and maybe it's a term broader than ethics, than in ethical. We, we have ethical norms. We also have norms for good carpentry or good calligraphy and so on. But concerning societal norms, and this is something that is said explicitly in the Manavadharma Shastra, it's not said explicitly in Nyaya, but I again dare say that this is presupposed by all the Nyaya philosophers, that where we get our norms are from trustworthy experts. And who are the experts concerning societal norm? Our parents. We learn the right ways to behave. Everything from table manners to how to greet people, the right way to greet people, the right way to write the alphabet, the various occupations that we learn and engage in everyday life, and ethical actions, just another one of these, right? To be, kind, to be charitable, and so on. These are norms that we pick up from the people of authority in our society, namely our parents and some others. And Mimamsa Sutra 115 says, in effect, that dharma is known by testimony. It says also dharma is something that's characterized by injunction. So we can, the Mimamsa school is mainly concerned with the Veda and Vedic injunctions. But I, when parents are conveying norms to children, Johnny, Chaitra, don't do that. Or yes, that's a good thing to do. And so they're do that. So I think injunctions, even as just a grammatical form, the Mimamsas have an enormous amount to say about injunctions. That it's also a very important theme in the ethical philosophy of Immanuel Kant, who may be the most important ethical philosophers in the whole long history of Western philosophy. In any case, that's a kind of side point. It seems to me that the right way to frame, to sort of step back and frame what we've learned so far, is that we have a kind of conventionalism. That what are the standards? What are the criteria for right action? Well, they're the conventions that are established in one society. Now, this may not be going, quite far enough. But conventionalism is a well-known view in contemporary ethical debates. And it's supported mainly what sometimes is called a meta-ethical argument about the meaning of, meta-ethics has to do with the meaning of ethical terms. Not, it's sort of a step above the whole argument about the criteria of right action to say, well, how do we even understand the various terms that we use in ethical discourse, such as right, good, ought to, should do, et cetera. How do we understand? What meaning? And so the conventionalist says, well, those meanings are determined just like other meanings in the society by convention. There are various linguistic conventions that are in place that connect with patterns of action, what are in Sanskrit called vyavahara. So the way people normally get along in the world, so that we know that, if you say hello to someone, the other person is being quite impolite and rude. It's a kind of an unethical action not to greet you back. There's just one after another of sort of little norms or conventions governing right behavior in everyday life. And so we might sum them up as the conventions, or another word that's commonly used for this is the mores, M-O-R-E-S, the mores of a society. And this is said that in a slightly different context, this is thought to be key to learning language in general. is to pick up the conventions. The speech is a kind of action. And so right speech is also a matter of incorporating or assimilating for oneself the conventions that are in place in one society. And so at this point, I'd like to remind you of our main verse that says, you know, whatever the best do, so that other people do. And the pramana, remember the word pramana, that's the word for knowledge source. That's the key idea in Nyaya philosophy. So what the pramana that the best set, kurute, loka, the world, follows. Now, one of the central problems facing the ethical view known as ethical conventionalism is that it makes ethical reform puzzling. Okay, if right behavior is defined by the conventions in place in your society at a particular time, like, I don't know, time T1, you know, say 30 years later, time T2, they change, right? I mean, so we have, I don't know, women's liberation movement, or I don't know, various, there seems to be, let's hope, progress in the ethical practices of a society, and so some, you know, unfortunate conventions, I don't know, to pick on one in the Indian context, say sati. It's nice that convention, though I think my wife's going to revive sati in the States, and so we can have a no. I mean, actually, there should be on the other side, right? I know if she dies, I'm going to throw myself on her funeral pile, and as the kind of, I know, to make up for all the bad male, you know, behavior. Anyway, I'm sorry, my jokes sometimes fall flat. You can see that that conventionalism does, I mean, if we want to think that conventions, you know, are improving, I mean, by what standard are we saying that, right? Because it seems like the conventions in place at a particular time, they're determining what's right, so how can you ever have ethical reform? So there's a kind of dilemma. Do they change without reason? And you want to say, no, they don't change without reason. The reason we have, you know, women's liberation movement or whatever, it's not without reason. There are good reasons why we have this change. Well, then it seems like ethical conventionalism can't be right, because those reasons would be standards that transcend the conventions of the time, and it's according to those standards that we get the change in the conventions. So that seems to be the heart of the problem. I guess the advocate of ethical of conventionalism could say, no, you can't give an account. You know, conventionalism is true, and we admit we can't. It's just that, you know, just without reason, there's just a change. Just the conventions change, and so yeah. Now with the new conventions, you can go back and judge that the old patterns were bad, but you can't say why there was the change. That would be, you know, to give up our theory. But then that seems really strange that there are these just arbitrary changes like that, you know, make it so arbitrary. That doesn't seem a very attractive view to me. It may be internally consistent, but it makes these changes just anomalies, unlike other natural occurrences. Now, I want to go back to Udayana, because Udayana, in this particular work where I was trying to find some leadership in this ethics, what he's mainly focused on is an argument for the existence of God that I call the criteriological argument. And here he's arguing for God, saying that standards, actually he uses the word vyavahara, as we'll see. He says that All the standards and that are shown in weavers' excellence in making cloth, the conventions in verbal acts, children learning the alphabet in a certain order, in the Devanagari alphabet, and so on, is very scientifically, you might want to say, very naturally arranged. But someone had to sort of come up with that insight and make that wonderful arrangement of the, you know, with all the, you know, the consonants in five classes and the semi-vowels and sibilants all grouped together and so on, unlike the Roman alphabet, we might say. I guess God didn't have a hand in that one. Again, another bad joke. I won't try anymore. All of these are thought to, maybe the best way to appreciate what's trying to be proved here, depend on an independent being, it's the idea that there has to be a standard setter. How do we get conventions and standards unless there's a standard setter? Now, we usually get them from our parents, but where did they get them? I mean, they can't just pop out of nowhere. They depend upon a standard setter, and so ultimately, that would be Ishvara, and the reason is because they are conventions. Well, what do we mean by conventions? We have to have some analogy here, some inductive support. Let me just read this. This is like the expertise that is a causal factor in the production of an exquisite pot, the likes of which has never been encountered before, skill in a craft that is comparatively better, as well as the meaning of the sequences in the Paninian grammatical system. And what's going on is, I think, to sort of step back from the literal words and think about how he's arguing, what he's saying is, there seems to be an easy counterexample to this argument, that because sometimes with the exquisite pot, the likes of which has not been encountered previously, sometimes human beings break the mold and set standards themselves. There's an invention. There's something new. Right? We have moral reform, or we have I don't know. Discoveries by great geniuses, and what Udayana is what he goes on to say, how he ends this whole passage. He says, "Hail to weavers, hail to potters." And so, the idea here is, in that moment, this is not a counterexample. In that moment, when there is setting of new standards. I eliminated one of them. When you name a child, you're setting a convention. That is a sacred act. So when there's a breakthrough in setting of new standards, the person who's making the breakthrough is really channeling the divine. That is the divine in action now, right? So when the human is a genius. I mean, maybe this person may not be, you know, this goes back sort of like the Vibhuti theory of the Book of Gita, chapter 10, may not be perfect in every aspect of her or his life, but in that standard setting, in that breaking the mold, that person is divine. So this way, Ishvara then is operative, even in those cases where, what the Yoga Sutra says, there's actually, I was having in mind a different sutra, but the Yoga Sutra says about the Ishvara that the Ishvara is the teacher of the ancients. So I think this is also the idea that Udayana is picking up on, that's the first teacher, but also, as he's saying, it's the present teacher. So there is this idea of creativity, of divine creativity that's imminent in the world, in us. And this is thought in the Yoga Sutra, this is said that yoga, most people, I mean, Yoga Sutra has a very negative view of human psychology, that we're all like sheep. We just, our minds run on and we think everything that everybody else, they're noisy where, you know, that basically we need to just not think and be quiet. But there are some unusual sutras in the Yoga Sutra that says the yogi or yogini, despite everyone else as sort of being thinking what everybody else thinks and being can make new citta, new patterns of thought, including new standards of excellence. The very next verse of the Gita, beyond the one that you know, that we started with today, 321, 322, Krishna says, "I, the divine being, abide in actions." So this is all, I think, this whole passage is supporting Udayana's thought. Now, is this the end? Oh, my last slides or something, didn't get through. I'll just have to, I'll just have to tell you the last part here. I don't know, I don't know what happened. I'm, it seems like I've been dropping the last slides. I did that at the last talk I gave. It seems to me what's going on in the Bhagavad Gita is you know, at first Krishna is telling Arjuna that he should do his duty, and stand up. His duty is as a kshatriya, fighting a righteous war, is to go out and fight, despite this yogic urge that Arjuna expresses right at the beginning, that, you know, if you know the context from the Upanishads, that ahimsa, non-injury, and regard for your fellow being is supposed to be the greatest of the yogic virtues. And so you think that Arjuna, knowing that the Gita is a little manual on yoga, you think that Arjuna is doing the right thing, at least that's my reading, when he refuses to fight. That's what Gandhi also thinks. He also thinks that the whole Kshatriya war is just a metaphor. I don't think that's right. But the point is that through, I mean, the basic teaching seems to be that you need to become a witness and not take your action quite so seriously. You act in a spirit, you do what has to be done, and you do it in a spirit of offering or sacrifice. But there's also this sense normally people are controlled by their nature, just as the Yoga Sutra says, that we're just moved by the natural desires that we have as being human beings. Some of us have tamasic natures, some of us rajasic, some are fortunate to have sattvic natures, but we're all sort of moved by the qualities of nature, and that's just the way the world is. And don't worry about it. Just you live according to your nature and so on. And the best thing to do is to get some distance from it, to appreciate that it is a play, and cultivate your inner awareness that the action itself is not so important. But and he also says in this 321 that, you know, the world, you should follow the standards that have already been set. And he implies that he is the one that set the standards, right? The standards that the Shrestas, the best, have set, the world follows. You are the world, Arjuna. You follow those standards. Do your duty. Do your swadharma. You know, you're acting in accordance with the patterns that have been set. But you also get the idea that here he's, after he's been practicing all this yoga, and, you know, that he's becoming more and more, Arjuna's becoming more and more like Krishna, and so more and more of possibly an innovator. So I want to put out the idea that, you know, ultimately in character ethics, what's being relied on is a kind of intuition in the present moment. The person of good character doesn't need intellectual formula the way the criterion theorist has, but is able, by appreciating all the factors that go into action, all the various people's feelings that are involved in a particular line of action, the consequences, the intentions of all the various people, And the problem with a kind of intuitive, or what's technically called an intuitionist theory of ethical judgment, where is that it seems like our moral guide is not very sure. We're so self-interested that we're very good for calculating our own interests, but we don't really have the kind of objectivity that makes very plausible the idea that we have a kind of ethical organ that perceives, like our sense organs, ethical truths in the moment. And that's what it seems as though the character ethicist is saying. But I want to say that the process of yoga and of also of developing good character in general, I think is supposed to be a kind of purifier that, over and over again, Krishna is telling Arjuna, to not to act for the fruit of his actions, to give up desire for the fruit, just do the action itself. And so, and other forms of yoga. And so through this process of yoga, it seems as though Arjuna is becoming like Krishna, a kind of ideal ethical observer. An ideal ethical observer. And you know, Krishna in many places says, I act for holding together the worlds, loka samgraha. I have the interest of everyone at heart, right? Not my own interest or your interest, but of holding together all the worlds. And Arjuna seems, as he progresses, learns the teaching of Krishna, he seems to be, so I want to assimilate, he seems to be becoming the ideal ethical observer like Krishna, so that he himself no longer needs to just follow conventions. He becomes the kind of creative spirit who's like the exquisite weaver or exquisite pot maker, the pot maker in Udayana's argument, criteriological argument, who can come up with new norms. So it seems to me that there is through this teaching of Krishna and of sort of divine creativity an answer to the problem within ethical conventionalism of ethical reform. Remember, the problem is that it doesn't seem as though, if conventions are what are defining right action and wrong action in the ethical sphere, like the sphere of carpentry and pot making and so on, then how can we ever have change, right? How can we have reform? It doesn't make sense that, this just seems to happen. Well, here's how it makes sense. There is the original sort of standard setter. And that standard setter is the Ishvara, but the Ishvara can also be the potter. The Ishvara can be Arjuna. So that through yoga, which opens you to divine creativity, one becomes an ideal ethical observer where one's intuitions then need not conform to conventions, right? And so you are then in a position to break the norms or to set new norms. Now that's it. That's the teasing out that I want to do of the Naiyayika theory, criterion theory, in the first place, a matter of testimony, that we learn conventions by testimony. But there's an extra wrinkle in that theory where it's not just testimony, because there is room in this theory for ethical reform through divine creativity. Divine creativity, you could even do without the word divine. The creativity that fortunately people express from time to time when humans advance and new standards are set. Well, thank you for your attention. So am I going to field questions or are you? Okay.
I have many questions, but I'll just ask maybe a couple of them. It seems to me that the criteria theory that you are kind of carving out in the Nyaya tradition actually depends heavily on the character theory, right? Because it's a testimony, but it is a testimony of a standard setter.
That's right.
Or a standard person, apta.
That's right.
Okay, and who is presumed to be or expected to be?
That's right.
Or is should be necessarily a person of character, right?
That's right.
So actually, in our regular life, actually it's a theory of criteria,
right.
But essentially, it necessarily depends upon the character theory.
Right. What you're bringing out is that it's really no fault or flaw in the Nyaya view that they don't focus on the criterion because they are principally an ethics of character. They're promoting an ethics of character because it is the character of the opta that is crucial, as indeed for in the Bhagavad Gita, it's the character that one develops through practicing yoga, the kind of purification, the ethical purification to be able to see clearly what is in the interest of all the worlds, right? Knowing all the consequences of the action and everyone that's affected and so on, that makes one capable or gives one the right to break the norms. And so I sort of think that's the sort of sense you get at the end of the Gita, that Krishna is sort of saying, okay, you should be able to see for yourself what's right. And Arjuna then does it not because it's the old norm, but the new norm. That he sort of sees himself that fighting is the right thing to do in these circumstances.
Hello, sir. I'm trying to make sense of what you said in terms of modern concepts that I am aware of. See, when you say that only a yogi can break the conventions and sort of set new conventions, only an yogi is able to make sense of everybody's interest, not just one's own interest. So what is the notion of self of a yogi? Or is there an aspirational notion of a self when one aspires to be a yogi? And probably if I'm just able to relate a yogi who breaks convention versus the initial person who set the conventions, that's an Ishvara. Is it to say that he is just omniscient and not omnipotent or omnipresent, but just omniscient because he is able to take cognizance of everybody's interests?
Okay. First of all, I think that teaching in the Gita is, though it is said, there's a famous verse, I think it's in chapter 2, Yoga Kaushalam. Yoga Karmasu Kaushalam. Yoga Karmasu Kaushalam. The yoga skill and works. What I was going to say that it's in the sphere of ethics that the purification of yoga is required. Unless I don't know someone who could have done it in a previous lifetime and be born with good ethical judgment. But in other areas, weaving. Pot making, Paninian grammar, and so on. It's not really tied to yoga, but you know, everyone can channel creative energies and set new standards. It's going to be a little different in the various domains of Vyavahara, of the norms of life. But in ethics, that's where Krishna in the Gita does really champion the, what do you want to say, the non-self-interested perspective of the yogin. So that comes to your second set, question. Well, what is the self of the yogin? Well, that question, what is the self, is the most hotly disputed of all the questions, even within Vedanta, right? Even within that classical school really takes its inspiration from the Upanishads and the Bhagavad Gita. And then when you add Nyaya, which is not so heavily influenced by the Upanishads and the Gita, but though they also read and respect the Upanishads and the Gita, and the Buddhist schools and so on, this is very hotly contested, the precise nature of the individual self or universal self. But I think, not to totally dodge your question, Krishna does make plain a kind of universalism, right? That that it's everyone's interest, right? Sarvahite rataha, right? Delighted in the interest of every being. And so that seems to be the mark. I mean, forget the yogin word, the word yogin. It's the person who is able, through appreciating the divine Brahman, has a kind of vision of equality, of everyone counts, everyone who's affected, everyone's welfare is a concern of this person. So it seems to me that this really marks the Bhagavad Gita as a great turning point in Indian spirituality, where the goal of the discipline is no longer just nirvana, something personal, but some real concern that one, through the practice, becomes a person who's delighted in the welfare of everyone, who's got the holding together of all the worlds, the harmony of all the worlds at heart. And so it seems to me that that's what makes one an ideal ethical observer, that insofar as one can have the interest of everyone at heart, then one is in the best position to make ethical judgments and to set new norms. And so it's a very high bar. It's, what I should do is follow the norms. But there are going to be people who rightly break the norms, and can tell us why too.
Since I have the mic, I guess it's my turn to. It's a comment I'd like to share. I'm trying to connect what I just heard you speak to a piece of work I'm doing just now. I'm translating a Kannada novel, the first Kannada social novel, written in 1899. It is titled Indira Bai or Sadharma Vijaya. So the title, Sadharma Vijaya, I would like to draw your attention to it. And this is a novel which is set in the context of tradition facing colonial modernity, and how at the turn of the century the kind of questions that were posed to convention, which had until then held sway, but a modern generation, English educated, and what is this clash between these two opposing sets of dharmas, and the sadharma that triumphs in the end is not the old dharma of conventionality, but the new dharma represented by this IAS officer who has gone abroad and educated abroad and comes back as the administrator to his own town, and he is able to rule with impartiality, objectivity, and the good of everybody in mind, and so on. Therefore, it is kind of trying to create a new dharma. So it's a creative.
But now, is the new dharma then supposed to be something unfortunate in this case, where there's not? I mean, what I was talking about was sort of presupposing progress in societal norms, right? The reform is for the better, but I know that's just that's not strictly true, just to set up a certain problem. Is it in this novel that the new dharma is somehow a regression, or is it supposed to be
it is not so much a divine creativity, way in which you define it, but this creative solution is seen in terms of a more secular, from non-divine kind of sources, coming from the current historical changes that were happening in society, and how those things were good for the current society. Therefore, not so much by way of a divine creative solution towards reform, as much as a more secular solution.
Yes, but the way Udayana is looking at, the way the Naiyayika Udayana, whose criteriological argument I cited, and from the Nyaya Kusumanjali, a text of the 11th century, the way he's looking at it is the pot maker who makes an exquisite pot the likes of which has never been encountered previously is divine. That person deserves worship, indeed being garlanded. Maybe he may be, maybe not the perfect husband, have to have a conscious agent in the collection of causes that are responsible for bringing them about. The Buddhists put up the objection that, okay, how about growing grass? Growing grass is an effect, but growing grass does not have a conscious agent in the bundle of causes that are together sufficient for bringing about growing grass. It has, air and soil and so on, moisture. And then the Nyaya response to that is, well, that's an illicit counterexample. Because when we say earth and the like have a conscious agent in the collection of causes that bring them about, we include growing grass along with earth. I mean, that's what we're reasoning about. And the point of inference is to bring about new knowledge. You know that the pot has a conscious agent to bring it about. You don't know that earth, but you also don't know that. So the question is about growing grass. The question is about earth and the like, and growing grass is like the earth. It's not evident that it has a conscious agent, and so our inference is proving that growing grass, like earth, has a conscious agent. And so then the Buddhists come back and say, but your examples that you're giving, a pot, a cloth, and so on, where there is a conscious agent within the causal nexus that's bringing about the effect, those conscious agents all have a body. And Ishvara doesn't have a body. So your argument is no good. And the Naiyayika say, yes, Ishvara does not have a body, because if Ishvara had a body, bodies are collections of atoms. And so Ishvara is the one that, puts the collection in the right order so that, we have a body. And so if Ishvara had a body, there'd have to be another Ishvara to arrange the atoms, and so there'd be an infinite regress. And so so the Naiyayikas agree, but then they say, but, says Udayana, Ishvara has the power to assume a body when Ishvara wants to. And so the main reason that the Ishvara assumes a body is to teach. The Ishvara assumes a body in order to teach. The Ishvara assumes a body in order to set the standards in the various domains of human life, and including ordinary Mr. Potter, who makes an exquisite pot the likes of never encountered before, including, I don't know, Mahatma Gandhi, including Martin Luther King. That's sort of the idea that people who really break the mold and set new standards are Ishvara taking a body in order to teach us something. Mm-hmm. That's how Udayana is thinking of it.
Thank you very much for your talk. It gives one many things to think about. I was wondering if, from what you presented, is this a right interpretation that this breaking of convention, rather than being something like a radical moment, is internal to the domain or activity itself? That is, it is brought about by the reflection on conventions itself. So if you go back to the Arjuna-Krishna dialogue, so Gandhi also interprets it in this way. Gandhi says that Arjuna's problem can't be ahimsa because he's been in other wars and he's killed people. So killing somebody might not be his problem. His problem is killing people he has grown up with, his teachers, his friends, his family, and so on. So Gandhi's interpretation is that Krishna is therefore saying, do duty without without keeping the ends in the sight. So do action without keeping the ends in mind, or without the product, so nishkama karma. So in this dialogue also, one sees that this breaking of the mold is something which is coming from a reflection on conventions itself. So I was thinking, one example, other than say weaving and carpentry or pottery, could be the university as a domain. Now we see that university is a practical domain. It is heavily dependent on conventions and passing that on and so on. So what you said about the yogi, that you don't expect students to be breaking the norm. You expect them to be learning it in robust fashion, in conventions, learning them. But you expect somebody in the university systems to be breaking the norm or thinking about norms. So.
But wait, just one moment on that. You have to be careful. I used, unfortunately, maybe the expression breaking the mold, because, you know, of course, there are two senses of breaking the norm. And I think that that one has to appreciate I've been focused on the problem of ethical reform for this talk, but the Nyaya ethics is, I think, a conventionalism, and for most cases, breaking the norms is something bad, right? I mean, that's something we shouldn't do. We should act according to the norms. I mean, that's the central message of conventionalism and of a criterion theory of testimony, where we're learning the norms from the teaching of our parents and other people of authority, is just like what you're saying with the students. If a student breaks a norm, channeling Saraswati. It's more likely, I don't know. I'm sorry, my humor is not up to. It's a long ride from the airplane in the States, that and comics, they have to be quick, and if it doesn't come quickly, I'm sorry. I know there's not much guidance in what I've said so far about facing two sets of conventions, right? I mean, this is sort of a way of sort of saying when one set of conventions displaces another set of conventions, as in, I don't know, the civil rights movements, and it's a way of interpreting conventionalism to make it a coherent philosophy in ethics. But I, in nothing in what I've said so far really is illuminative of the problem of if you're faced with two sets of conventions, of two sets of norms, how do you decide? Maybe it's in the ideal observer theory, though. If you can take the perspective of someone who's disinterested, who cares about the welfare of everyone equally, then it should be apparent to you, though we cannot say in advance what your decision is going to be. You should have, you know, the sort of the ability to be an ethical observer in the right way. You know, we talk about that in the sciences, right? It's not just anyone that can look under a slide under the microscope and tell us what's there. There has to be training. You have to, your dispositions to look at something a certain way get trained and corrected by a kind of community effort. Well, I think that's what yoga is supposed to be doing in the Bhagavad Gita on this ethical domain, is making Arjuna aware of the big picture, that, you know, after all, the Pandava side is in the right, the Kuru side is in the wrong, and, you know, that's, you know, maybe he can't see that because he's, you know, he sees his archery teacher on the other side and so on, but, and so by that kind of the purification of yoga, getting rid of self-interest, one is able to see, and so maybe the same thing would hold about the problem of being faced with competing sets of conventions. What to do is to try to take a perspective that has concern with the harmony of everything. Though that seems kind of vacuous. I mean, those very lofty words. It's maybe not very practical.
Thank you very much for a very lucid presentation. From the inside, I think it looks very logically connected, etc. But suppose someone asks a question from outside the framework, is it very strongly authoritarian in the sense that you have to follow the Shrestha and norms convert set by Shrestha? And only someone who, this seems to be in a way appreciation of excellence, and the standard of excellence are always governed by the people who control the society. Therefore, it goes in a loop and keeps the ethical control in the hands of the people who are already controlling it. That is one question. Does it get into that loop? That is one question. The second question is slightly different. I don't know the worth of that, but I'll still ask. There also seems to be more than one references in Mahabharata, things like Atmavat Sarvabhutesu and don't do to others which you don't want others to be done to you. So when people think of the ethics in this sense, then why almost never these kinds of things which break this loop of authority are never referred? Are they less important, or what is the matter? The third one is a very mundane kind of information. In the beginning, I noticed that yesterday you chanted something or recited something in Sanskrit, and today also you did. What does that mean, and what is its purport? That's a sort of just information seeking. You can, if you don't like, you don't take notice of that.
Well, no, that's it. That's easy. That's easy to know that traditionally, when one begins anything, one does mangalam, right? And so mangalam means doing something auspicious. And doing something auspicious is supposed to set a certain atmosphere that makes, I don't know, things. So the word om is mangalam. Or breaking a coconut and offering it, Namah Sri Ganeshaya, is mangalam. And so all the Upanishads start with a mangalavachanam. In fact, most Sanskrit literature has mangalam. So I just following convention and having a little mangalam, and then I did a mangalam to Saraswati, who's the goddess of learning, who, you know, Om Aim Saraswatyai, which is...
Acharya, I have a question that goes along with
the question. Then he had two other questions.
First question that he asked about the authority, I have a sub-question within the tradition he's asking.
Okay.
So I thought it can answer both together. So I'm asking, at what point does apta become adhikara? When does appropriateness turn into eligibility or an authoritarian criteria? So you could have the Mimamsa scholar saying that it is, since all the shastras are in the hands of, let us say, a particular community, therefore it is that community which has the final word, or that is the apta, and therefore it becomes authoritarian.
It's the other way around. It's the... The adhikata, you know, the adhikata is the apta. First, you have to fulfill the adhikata, the prerequisites, right? The eligibility requirements to become an apta. But the way the Nyayikas use it, it's not in the sort of exclusive way that it's used among the Mimamsakas, the priest, and the Brahmins and the Vedantins and so on. They're thinking about, you know, the craftspeople, experts, and because. In that very same sutra, 117, Nyaya Sutra, they say even a Malecha, which means a person, a foreigner, an outsider, can be an apta in a particular domain. If that person knows the truth in that domain, now that person is probably not going to know the truth about heaven and sacrifices, but a Malecha, a weaver or potter or, you know, a craftsperson or astronomer, that the Nyaya is very open to accepting views from other areas, other shastras, like medicine and so on. They say whatever's the siddhanta in another area, we'll accept into our own system so long as there's no obvious contradiction that we can't solve. But I think the real thrust of Rohit's question, at least the first question, was conventionalism seems to be atavistic or too stultifying. That, you know, to look upon the norms of the status quo, it's going to be the authorities, whatever you may think are the real authorities. Right. Remember, the real authorities are, as people pointed out, are people who have character, those character traits that I listed, right? Charity, willing to serve, and so on. Those are supposed to be the optas in ethics. But you're saying, what seems really scary about a conventionalism is that it seems to be a defense of the status quo, and that, you know, various, you know, power brokers sort of who are the ones really controlling the norms. And I just want to say that's not really the theory, right? The theory is a kind of misapplication of the theory. That's not the fault of the theory, that people in power who assume authority when they shouldn't have authority in these domains, that's not saying the theory's wrong. That's just saying that it's not instanced in these cases. I can also see that there is a kind of conservatism in this theory. But that is what has been the principal criticism of it. And the thrust of my remarks today is that it's not an entirely conservative theory. It has this openness to it that has to do with creativity in various domains of life, including ethics, so that there is an openness to change. But it's not just, you know, it has to be very special people who do set the new norms, and hopefully society will protect itself against such others. So we'll maybe have time for a couple more, okay? If some of you need to leave, I know that you may have other schedules. My students walk out on me all the time, so it doesn't bother me.
Yes, sir. So you started the speech by doing Mangalam. So that was you were invoking Ishvara. That is what I understood. So in that sense, can I interpret it this way, that you were invoking the creative potential, which is Ishvara, and when you were in your best, when you were explaining the theory the best, it is Ishvara that is working through you. So can we interpret?
Wow. Who could have the hubris to claim that, right?
I mean, yeah, exactly. So the point I just want to raise is, when you said the example of potter or a weaver, even in this example, so long as you don't claim yourself to be Ishvara, and so long as we get the benefit of creative potential, which is flowing through you, there is no, isn't it right to see somebody as Ishvara in that sense?
Well, that's true. I think that's the sort of ideal that's set in the Gita, is to, try to make yourself I think that the main upfront message is, don't worry about the action and the results and so on. Try to be, more stoic, not bothered by results. You're too much engaged. You're too much worried about what's right and what's wrong and so on. Just do what needs to be done. Follow your dharma. And try to take the perspective of the sakshin, and attend to your inner life. The outer life is, it's really beyond your control and so on. But there is I think that is the main message, but there is another message on top of that, that is that yes, you can be a vehicle of divine action. But I think that's secondary to the other message, which is, it's just you follow the norms, but I want to bring out the second message because to me, it really is a problem theoretically for ethical conventionalism that it doesn't make room for meaningful reform, and I think that the conventionalism of Nyaya, in line with the Gita, does have room for reform.
So, sub-question related to this. So you said this the idea of creative potential as Ishvara from a Nyaya's perspective. But when I was reading Gita from the Advaita Vedanta perspective also, this very same idea is mentioned there. And especially in the chapter 2, verse 10, Sahayajna Praja Srishtva, the explanation to that particular shloka is also solely from the perspective of this creative potential. But I'm really confused. So what is the difference between Nyaya perspective and Advaita Vedanta perspective in this particular?
Enormous difference. Enormous difference in that the Nyaya has a very different theory of action from Advaita Vedanta, from any kind of Vedanta. Nyaya has the theory that the Atman acts immediately, that chikirsa, desire to do, is a property that does have real effects in the world. And according to Shankara, it's just an illusion that you're really acting. You're not acting. You're just, you're action is going on. The nature of the self is that it's not an actor. It's an observer. It's a witness, but it doesn't really inaugurate action. All action comes from prakriti. That's not the Nyaya view. So the Nyaya view is much more in line with Vishishta Dvaita Vedanta than it is with, and indeed, the Vishishta Dvaita Vedanta, such as Ramanuja and Vedanta Deshika and all those, they borrow from Nyaya in combating Advaita Vedanta in their inner school debates. I would say Nyaya, particularly in late classical Indian philosophy, really lines up as one of the enemies of Advaita Vedanta.
I have two brief questions. They're not related. The first question is, it almost looked like what Udayana is saying about Ishvara is, it seemed to me like natural law.
Yeah, the Ishvara is responsible. Well, not entirely for natural law, but that's right. That for order, because there are some properties of things that go all the way down that the Ishvara is not responsible. For example, the nature of atoms. The Ishvara is not responsible for the fundamental nature of atoms. Atoms are eternal. But all combinations, you're right, all sort of the way things fit together and so on, the Ishvara has a hand in. And continually, not in the way there was a what's called a deism, you know, as a while in the early period of science in the West, where it's thought, well, God gets the universe, winds up the universe, and then steps back, has nothing to do with it, and then it's all natural law. But in the Nyaya conception, no, Ishvara continually is involved in, which makes sense with this argument about the weavers, you know, that, or the potters who break the mold and set, you know, by making an exquisite pot that the likes of never which has been encountered, that's really, you know, the ongoing creativity of Ishvara.
The second question is a much longer question that I've had since I used to read the Gita, is there is a sense that Swadharma and Swabhava are ideally should go together. Almost there's a place where it says you can't actually go against your Swabhava.
Right. Your Swabhava and Swadharma are very related concepts, right?
Yeah,
what you are by Swabhava, by your own nature that you've born with, just accept it. That's the way you are. Actually, the Advaitins go further with this. The Advaitins seem to think that, you know, even when you're doing karma yoga, any action is appropriate, that even if you can be a thief, and if you have the right attitude towards your thievery. But Ramanuja and others don't think that's right, that there's a kind of constraint in the giving, that you want to do something beautiful and acceptable. So it's not just that anything goes. They have tighter norms than the Advaitins.
Personally, they do seem to conflict at times.
The Advaitins and the Vishishta Advaitins conflict all the time. And lots of things. Well, not everything, but. Okay.
So in the sources of knowledge, you had listed perception, inference, testimony, and analogy, and you had mentioned why perception is not relevant, and you had mentioned why testimony becomes very important in
right.
this way of thinking. But
right.
what about inference? Maybe I missed that
well,
part. What is
well,
its role?
Well, inference is not like Kantian reason, right? Kant thinks, where do we get these... what's the source of ethical knowledge? It's supposed to be reason. You know, it's only the maxims of our actions that can be universalized. It's reason. So you might want to think that it would be inference, like with Kant. It's reason that gives us the basic principles and norms of ethics. But inference in the Nyaya context, as in general in all the classical Indian schools, has a strong inductive element. There's no a priori. There's no sort of reasoning just on its own that's not informed by experience. So when I make an inference to fire over there on the mountain, the reason I'm from seeing smoke, It's not perception, because I don't see the fire. I know there's fire over there, and I know it by inference. It's not pratyaksha, it's paroksha. But that inference depends upon my having previously had perception. questions of the connection of smoke and fire, having previously heard other people tell me that whenever you see smoke, there's going to be fire there. And so I have a lot of background information that feeds into the premise, wherever there's smoke, there's fire. So the inference works, wherever there's smoke, there's fire. There's smoke over there on the mountain, therefore there's fire over there on the mountain. But that's not a sort of pure rational inference. It's an inference that's informed by an inductive generalization. In other words, lots of experience of the connection before I make this particular inference of smoke and fire being together. And so when it comes to ethics, we would have to say, if it's inference that tells us, that means perception would have to first tell us. We'd have to know this ethical characteristic of being good by perception, and that's already been ruled out. So if perception is ruled out, then inference is ruled out. The Mimamsakas say that very explicitly in the commentaries on Mimamsa Sutra, I think 115. Yes, in ordinary life, there can be chains of testimony, but there is a certain dependence on perception and inference in testimony, in that for a person to be an opta, that person has to know the truth, and so that person could have learned the truth by some other testifier, so we have chains of testimony. But you would think that at the end of these chains is going to have to be someone who knows the truth by perception. And then Nyaya philosophers admit that. So it does seem in everyday affairs that testimony is also dependent upon perception. However, testimony when it comes to ethics, just as testimony about imperceptible things we rely on the Veda, but testimony concerning ethics depends upon our teachers. That's why we need some special starting point. That's why we need Ishvara. And that's really the thrust of the argument for Ishvara, is that otherwise we would have this unending stream of testimony that can't be grounded in perception, because perception doesn't give us ethical knowledge, and it can't be grounded in inference. So how is it grounded? Well, it's got to be grounded in some other way, namely, in an independent being who is a standard setter, and that's the issue.
A small historical question. You mentioned Ishvara becomes a concern for the later Nayakas.
Right.
So what is the question? How is reform handled before Ishvara becomes central? One second, the question of intuition. I think too much is being, there's a lot is at stake on this. So I wonder if there's extended considerations of issues of erroneous intuition or misplaced intuition, or is it taken to be a pure thing which can be relied upon without much
I think that in early Nyaya, before Udayana, before this sort of explosion of texts that really begins with Udayana, or maybe a little earlier, and really gets going in the 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th centuries, in the earlier period, I think it's pretty much straightforwardly a character ethics that as was pointed out, it's also really still a character ethics even post Udayana. And that character ethics is tied to reincarnation, also mukti, and search with mukti. I think this idea of, and I think Udayana does too, of ethical intuition under ideal circumstances of observation from the Gita. And I think in the early stages, the Nayayikas don't even know about the Gita. I mean, they're not really interested. They're kind of, they're basically debate coaches. They're in the court of the king, and you have to give a speech, and so they tell you how you can win your argument, and they're criticized in some early texts for being not religious. They're free thinkers, but over time, they become defenders of the Hindu Dharma, and Udayana, I think, represents the greatest turn there with his arguments. But I just don't think that this dimension that I'm bringing out today with Udayana is really there in the earlier text. So I take it back. It is in Vajaspati also. So is it, if it's in Vajaspati, is it in Ujjotakara? Well, I think it really starts with Vajaspati. I'd have to go back and look. I have to go back. I have to do some digging. You got me stumped here on this one.
All right, thanks very much, Stephen, and okay. Thank you everybody for coming. We surely hope that this is the first of many engagements you'll have. Okay, thank you everybody, and have a good rest of the day.
Okay.